And welcome to all to our session this morning. It is coincidental that May is Older Americans Month, and it is fitting that we are talking about a group of older Americans who have contributed to our American society. Our goal today is to share information that may help with assessing dementia in older Filipino Americans and talk about important features of caregiving for this group. As we go through our slides, please send in your questions and we will respond to them after our presentation. And this slide lists the topics we intend to cover, including three cases to illustrate some key points in the presentation. Now I'd like to talk a little bit about who are the Filipino Americans. For a general background, these predominantly immigrant groups' ancestral legacy comes from their homeland's geographical location and the fact that their family lived and still do in an archipelago of many islands, of which 1,000 islands are habitable, only 1,000 islands. As islander people, their societies are defined by its island's distinct culture and mores. Over time, influenced by a blend of Malayan, Muslim, Chinese, Spanish, American, and other Euro-Western cultures, this multiculturalism is characterized by having many ethnic languages, the latter used extensively, having many ethnic languages and 8 major spoken languages that are mutually unintelligible. The Filipino language, or Tagalog, and English are the nation's national languages, the latter used extensively for business, professional, church, and other activities. Typically, families are raised in their island language, and Tagalog is used for teaching from first to third grade. Today, some immigrant Filipino children may need placement in special classes to help them transition into all English classrooms. For Filipinos, acculturation to different cultures begin early in life, which helps them adapt more quickly when they immigrate to the United States. This ability to embrace a host culture balanced by a natural inclination to form various types of groups provide a strong anchor for Filipino communities across the country. A predominantly religious people, mostly Catholic and other Christian religions, the church often provides the social glue and source of support for many of the Filipino-American families. And Dr. De La Cruz has studied acculturation using an instrument that she validated, and I'll talk about that in other slides later. This slide has a lot of information and it's quite busy. It simply summarizes the immigration history of the Filipinos in the United States, and I will not discuss this in detail, just a few comments. You will be able to get more information from some of the references listed at the end of this presentation. Briefly, the Filipino immigrants' experience dates back in the late 1500s when the Spanish galleon trade that went past North America provided opportunities to Filipinos who worked in these vessels to escape oppression by establishing themselves in Mexico, California, and Louisiana. After the Spanish-American War, Filipinos became American nationals, which an act of Congress changed later to alien designation. Eventually, the Naturalization and Immigration Act provided various strategies to come to the United States. As an immigrant group, generations of Filipino Americans experienced a range of economic, political, social, emotional, and physical difficulties, many of which were related to overt or covert discriminatory practices. Effects of these negative experiences, along with a history of colonization, may be expressed by immigrant families in their attitude towards formal systems, such as the healthcare system. Their successes in establishing productive and meaningful lives in American society are often celebrated in a variety of gatherings, such as church, cultural, and family gatherings. On this slide, currently, older Filipino Americans are the second largest Asian group and are predominantly foreign-born. Though almost all can speak English, there remains a strong preference for the Tagalog or their indigenous language. In healthcare, you are likely to encounter a geriatric Filipino patient who feel more comfortable with a provider who speaks Tagalog or prefers to have a family member present to translate information. English comprehension may be slowed down by the need to make direct translations of concepts from English to the patient's language and for those who have less education. In her acculturation study, De La Cruz found that older Filipinos who spoke more Filipino language at home and in social events tend to be more traditional and less acculturated. A clinician's approach to educating this type of patient would need to be culturally tailored to her or his needs. And before moving on to the next slide, many of you may have heard of the plight of the about 175,000 Filipino World War II veterans who were eligible for U.S. citizenship by a 1990 amendment to the Immigration and Naturalization Act to correct an inequity dating back to the end of World War II. It has been a long struggle to get veterans' benefits that was not included in the original amendment. Some corrections have been made, and veterans are receiving health benefits and remuneration. However, in 2003, out of the remaining 29,350 aging veterans, 7,000 are in the United States with varying benefits based on the type of service rendered, and the rest are still waiting for citizenship and benefits. They may still choose to immigrate and seek health care through the VA system. The immigration history of older Filipinos formed several groups in the older Filipino community. Those who immigrated as young adults or children may be considered as Filipinos who aged in place. And there are Filipino elders who came as followers of children to reunite with family and help raise young families. And in the 1950s, the shortage in the United States of medicine, nursing, and other healthcare professionals led to an influx of these highly educated Filipinos who are now the young old group. The Marcos regime brought young and middle-aged adults to the United States. World War II and the other wars, especially Korean and Vietnam War, are now seeing additional aging Filipino veterans. And Filipinos with temporary entry visas who seek education, health care, employment opportunities, and maybe to visit, just to visit families, are also part of this group of older Filipinos who you might see at some point in the healthcare setting, perhaps in an emergency basis, or for those who are here to seek health care. There are some cases where they come for the specialized services of specialized medicine. The healthcare professional who is involved in the assessment and management of dementia in older Filipinos would find it helpful to determine in the assessment process whether the patient or family has had direct or indirect experience with historical trauma or discriminatory practices. Potentially, it may influence the trust-building process or may exhibit itself when dementia-related cognitive changes progress over time. Certain things they say may not make sense to the family or clinician, but may originate from an unresolved post-traumatic stress disorder. SGEC has a monograph on cohort analysis that you might find helpful in further understanding the historical experiences of these groups and other older American minorities in the United States. And now I'd like to turn over the following slides to Dr. Arnel Joaquin.
Thank you, Ben. Good morning, everyone. I hope you're hearing me good. If I'm too loud or too soft, maybe you can type it in and let me know. So what I'll be doing in the next few slides is looking at this, the issues in assessment of dementia, and I'll be speaking from different aspects of my life. Basically, I have firsthand experience with growing in the Philippines about issues that we have had there. Also, as a clinician who saw many of our Filipino American patients, and also with whatever little literature we have available. And I think, as we will mention later, it's something that it can be a good research area to go into. And as you know, the dementia, the different information that we have are mostly studies in the Caucasian, African American, and Hispanic population. And according to the recent 2010 publication by the Alzheimer's organization, there's between these three groups, Caucasian, African American, and Hispanic, it's about 96% of dementia cases. So our other minority, which includes our Asian American, constitutes only about 4% of this population. So we always will have some caution, you know, needs to be exercised when dealing with the minority population not included in the study. And I'll point out some potential differences that, you know, we can see in Filipino Americans. And one of them in this slide, Filipino Americans may have some genetic predisposition that will make them prone to vascular dementia. And as you know, vascular dementia in the US comprise about somewhere between 10 and 15% of all dementia cases, which is actually the second most common, number one being Alzheimer's. In the Filipino Americans, although I didn't find any specific study, it is quite possible that the proportion of vascular dementia may be a little bit higher than just 15%, you know, compared to cases. This one was from a paper by Dr. Marasigan in the Philippines. This is talking about Philippine prevalence. 60 to 69 year old Filipinos, 11.5% have dementia. And if you look at the 70 year old and above, there's about 15.6%. Now, these numbers, if you look at it, actually comparable to the U.S. prevalence. And one of the things that he pointed out is in the Philippines, the establishment of dementia care facility is not catching up with you know, the demand, there's probably no demand, but it's slow in coming. This slide, I put it in just to highlight that when we talk about causes of mortality in the Philippines, dementia doesn't even come up in the top 10, whereas in the US, it's actually number 7. And there may be some reporting differences here, because I remember that when I was in the Philippines, we were not reporting dementia or Alzheimer's as a cause. For example, for an elderly Filipino, let's say, who died of pneumonia, aspiration pneumonia, but actually had dementia, we would tend to put pneumonia as the cause of death, or, as you can see, their lower respiratory infection. And not even so, the dementia aspect there wouldn't even be recorded. Here in the US, when we write for cause of mortality, if the patient has dementia and if we think the death was due related to dementia, even if it was an infection that happened, we would record it as a death due to dementia. Just showing here the life expectancy in the Philipp for Filipinos, and this is in the Philippines, but I would think that since a lot of our elderly Filipinos currently in the US migrated, at some point, this may be applicable, although they may have some increase because of improved healthcare here. But these life expectancies are almost 10 years less than the US population. Now, these are expected to increase, though, with according to the WHO. We won't spend too much time on this slide. This is from the recent 2010, and I'm The thing maybe I want to point out is the last report that we had about 4 million estimated population. Now we're at 5.3 million, and it's going to be expected to jump to about 14 to 16 million in the US by 2050, unless we find some kind of cure or some kind of modifying intervention. And as you know, if they get diagnosed with dementia, the life expectancy after that is about between 8 to 10 years. In the primary care setting, now this is American literature. We estimate that mild to moderate cases, this 50 to 66% of these patients are underdiagnosed or undiagnosed. So there's a lot of screening that we need to do, and as geriatricians, we were always educated and pushing for screening, mental health, psychiatry. Aspects, social aspects of patients, which hopefully the primary care is, catching up on in terms of screening our patients. And it may be it's really important to recognize this early, because there may be some interventions that can be instituted, which can definitely affect, future outcome. Talking about risk for older Filipinos, and again, I'm gonna refer somewhat to Filipinos when in the Philippines, but only because this may have affected their risk when before they migrated. So, age is still the number one risk factor. So as we age, we tend to have higher prevalence or higher risk. And the education, fewer years is of education is deemed not protected or at risk. Filipinos in the Philippines had probably decreased access of care, and this is due to the fact that in the Philippines, of course, you know that there's not really a good insurance system, so everything that patients there do, especially seniors, they have to pay for everything. And the chronic care tends to be episodic. In other words, you know, if they want to go, they will go. And if they don't feel anything, they obviously will not come to the doctor. One thing about the situation in the Philippines is if you are prescribed a medication, the pharmacy will keep filling up the prescription even without pre-authorization from the doctor. It's not like here where patients need to have pre-authorized refills. In the Philippines, as long as you have cash, you can get medications, and that's something that, you know, is makes follow-up very, like I said, episodic. Now, this slide, I would just explain that it's probably not, except for education, which is a protective factor as identified in the literature. The rest of this living arrangement, family support, and family income, these are things that are unique to the Filipino culture. In other words, seniors, Filipino elders, tend to live with their extended family or their children. And so there is good family support. And in a way, if they have some deficits, there's already that support that, you know, that they need to be able to function. Now, I would think that that's a double-edged sword because sometimes there's a delay of diagnosis, especially if a senior is dependent on intermediate activities of daily living. So before we detect any decline in their function, it's already going to be in the moderate, at least moderate to severe dementia range. Family income is something that can be a good resource for Filipinos who in the United States. Again, here we have they have more income than when they were in the Philippines. So this will allow them to have more resources. And looking at the model of care, in the Western model of care, we have mostly institution-based, which is expensive and not feasible in many underdeveloped countries. This may be culturally unacceptable in some Filipino elders. Now, I would probably step back a little bit to say that even though we discuss about Filipino elders as a group, we should also keep in mind that in our assessments, we actually still individualize, you know, patients because Among, as Melen pointed out earlier, even among Filipinos, there's a different dialects, different cultures, and they all have different a way of doing things. When I was in the Philippines giving a lecture about 10 years ago, I talked about the nursing homes where, you know, which is prevalent, which is common in United States. And when I was discussing that as an option for the Filipino elder with dementia, I had some, you know, most of the audience had expressed concern about the my openness in discussing that, you know, in the Philippines. So you can see where we're still, you know, not accepting, for example, putting our seniors in an institution. Mostly what's going to be acceptable to our Filipino elders is the home-based model, which could be least costly option. The only thing is we need to provide training to the caregivers and provide support to the caregivers. Now the 46% data is you know, for caregivers in the U.S. who are 50 to 64 years of age. This came from the Alzheimer's Organization data 2010. And I think this is true as well for Filipinos who are giving care to their seniors, to their demented elderly here in the US. A lot of my patients who had dementia, their children are actually the caregiver, or at least the main provider for the caregiving. So in the next few slides, we'll just talk about some quirks in assessing Filipino elderly. As Melen pointed out earlier, a lot of our seniors, Filipino elderly, would prefer a Filipino-speaking doctor if which, you know, they feel more comfortable. And I see this even in college graduate Filipino elders who don't speak Tagalog, I mean, who don't speak English at home or, you know, anywhere outside of their immediate home. And it's understandable because when you take a history and you give history, you lose a lot of symptoms and signs which are which the seniors would, you know, would often express. And so it's actually when you interview a patient, unless you speak Tagalog, you would probably want the family member also with you in the office, in the clinic, or have an interpreter, which in some instances we would really prefer an interpreter, since the senior might be somewhat intimidated, or they may not say the whole story when another family member is there. So we take medical history, medications, make sure that we ask about herbal medications and other over-the-counters that they take. And this is true for any other geriatric patients that we encounter. We have to ask about alcohol use or abuse. And importantly, living arrangement. I mentioned earlier that most seniors would live with their family, but again, we should be careful not to overgeneralize, because some Filipino seniors actually live by themselves. So, and again, it's due to the very maybe multiple factors, which we can, discuss later in the cases. So we do the physical exam, neurologic exam. When we talk about the screening for cognition, and in particular looking at the false theme, Melen had mentioned that a lot of Filipinos do speak the language, English language, and maybe not in conversation, but they, they, when asked in English, they would be able to answer, especially when you look at the false theme, which is really a pretty straightforward question about orientation, where they are, what date is it. In my experience, most seniors are able to complete the exam with little translation, except for, the really very low education where, they don't speak a word of English. I would just say that as we know, the false thing is affected by education and race, and so we need to adjust for that. But if we use the cutoff of 24, less than 24 out of 30, I think a screening tool would be something that we can use definitely in population. Now, the mini cog is actually, we won't talk too much about this, but this is a shorter version, and it's mainly a clock drawing and recall of three unrelated words, which they say could be used as a screening tool as well. And now, if once we they test positive for screening, then we would subject them to neuropsychologic testing. Now, this one I don't have, and this is probably another talk in itself, but neuropsychologic testing, as many of you know, would take about 2 to 3 hours to do. And some of them may be nonverbal, so it could be something that going to be applicable and would be able to complete, be completed by a Filipino elder. But there may be some testing that might need some translation. This slide will just, just for completion, we will obviously any other metabolic causes for dementia, especially things that can be reversed. And I would probably just like to say that in the Philippines, when we talk about dementia, it is quite possible, since the healthcare is again sporadic, that some of the dementia cases there might be from a reversible cause, and nobody will be able to determine that. And again, it's just because of the overall health situation in our, especially in the poor areas in the Philippines.
Arnel,
At
can
this
you hear
point,
me?
we'll go through three cases,
Thanks
and
for asking for comments on the previous slides.
I don't know
I
if
think
Nalen
just
would
one
like
thing
to
that
add
I just want to
anything
mention
before we go
is
to
the
the
importance of
cases.
checking during the assessment process medications that they may have brought from the Philippines, or if they happen to have taken vacation and returned to the U.S. to check whether they had medications that they're taking that were purchased in the Philippines. Right. Okay.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. And they do take take back medications because some medications they can buy cheaply. Okay. So should we go to the cases at this point? The first case is a Mrs. R.A., college educated. She came here at 50 years of age. She was able to petition her children, two children, and she retired at age 65 with good pension and social security. And she actually lived by herself. And this is one of the few instances where, I think when I was talking about generalization, since this Filipino elder actually came here at 50 and probably sort of become westernized, she didn't have any problems living by herself. And her two children had family, so that may have something to do with it. She didn't want to be, living with the spouses of their, of her children, and which could potentially have some tension. In fact, in the Philippines, these are, always a subject of situation comedies, about mother-in-laws. I'm sure it's the same here in the United States. That's why our in-laws usually live separately. And in the by the age of 70, this Mrs. R.A. started complaining about missing things. And one thing that was she complained about was the breaking ins, in her condominium. And at that point, she put up to 5 locks on her door. And the children were obviously concerned because in case of an emergency, she has to unlock 5 different locks before she can get out. But during all this time, she actually was functional outside the home. She can still use the public transportation. And when it became clear that she's not comfortable living at home by herself, the daughter and the husband took her, to their home. And in their home, some problems occurred where she tripped over speaker wires, fell, and over the next couple of years, before she died, her dementia had progressed quite progressively rapid, and until to the point that she was not able to recognize her children. She became incontinent. She was in a nursing home for the last year of her life, where she eventually died. In that case, what I was gonna just point out again is the situation of her living by herself and then being cared for at home, which is probably something that our Filipino, the culture of Filipinos is they won't automatically put them in the nursing home. The first sign of a problem or even important care facility. So the second
Yes,
option
in a
for
later
Filipinos would
slide,
be, you know,
I am going to talk about
the
some
seniors cannot
caregiving
live at home,
patterns.
they can
And
stay with the
certainly
family.
the
And
I think
maybe Melan can have some
the situation that was happening
input
here
on this case.
As far as Mrs. RA is that there was a definite choice to keep her out of an institution for as long as possible. And at the point when just about all resources of the family have been used, then the ultimate resource was the nursing home. And unfortunately, you know, that was that seems to support some of the notion that when you go to a nursing home, that's where you die.
Right, and and I think the that's a good point, and we can go to the next case, which is, you know, will have some relation to that statement. The second case is Mrs. RG, who immigrated in her late 60s. She was petitioned by her children, and she has history of hypertension, diabetes. Now, 2 years after she came to the United States, she had a stroke with the right side. She fully recovered, though, and for the longest time, she was living with her three adult children, rotating in the different household. Now, she developed memory changes, obviously, and that was after the stroke. The children started to feel, you know, stressed about safety issues. She would leave, you know, the gas stove on. So they didn't feel like she could be left alone at home when they're at work. So eventually she became frail. The decline in her mental function became severe, and she was hospitalized for chest pains. And at this point, because all the three children, again, were all, you know, were all employed, going to work. They have children already in college. Nursing home placement was actually entertained quite I mean, obviously, that was the main thing that led to her nursing home placement. Nobody was really available to stay with her when she was at home during the day. So in this case, I think even though, you know, we as geriatricians, we always say, you know, we try to keep the seniors in the lowest level of care possible. Because of resources, you know, it was not possible for the family to maybe
well,
hire
I'd like to just say one quick thing
that will be
and that
know,
is
taking
that
care of the senior
I think this
when
case
out
also suggests that
out.
Providing support group
and again, Melan,
to the family
can,
because
chime
they
in, but,
may be feeling that they
want,
have abandoned their
later,
older family member
case,
might be something
so can,
that would help them
sure.
Adapt to this this choice and decision that have been made that's somehow contrary to what they might have been raised as far as taking care of their elders.
Right, and yeah, there was a lot of guilt with this a case, and I know that they were actually visiting the senior their parent very quite often during this time. The third case is actually Mrs. RJ, who went to the United States, and she was already in her after retirement age, and she was able to be caregiver to her daughter's children when she came. And you know, I think that's one of the strong that's one of the cultural characteristic that we can expect from our Filipino elders is, you know, they wouldn't mind being caregivers to their grandchildren. Now, you know, this is probably true for a lot of our seniors in the United States. Although, you know, I think it's quite strong in the Filipino culture that it's almost expected that your parent, your grandparents can take care of your kids. I'm going to, for sake of time, we'll just point out that in this case, the senior got had a stroke as well. She became aphasic, which is really difficult I mean, that's one of the most difficult neurologic sequelae of a stroke is when you cannot express yourself. This patient actually was placed in a nursing home, but her condition deteriorated, so she had to so the actually the daughter took her back, and because she had resources, she was able to provide the full-time caregiver. So I think the next slide will show us some challenges in the Filipino patients. Let me see. I think there was a question about recommendations. Okay. We have Filipino patients who are probably not, like I said, not well-versed in, you know, conversing in English, especially with their providers. And I would say that what we would recommend in these instances is to have a knowledgeable relative be with the patient when they come, which is really a helpful which is really helpful when you take your history and screening. When you have absolutely no one, you know, that you can find, yeah, that would be a challenge. And I would say in that case, is to really look for a Filipino physician or provider, because that's the only other way that you can get through a who doesn't have the, you know, the command of English. And you know, we can also say that in terms of family values, the Filipino elders always, you know, you would expect them to respect authority. So when the doctor is evaluating the patient, usually you get a good compliance from the senior, the patient, the elderly Filipino patient. We can skip the slides in terms of, you know, the treatment and management. I think the focus of our course is assessment. Although if you have any questions, you can obviously email me. But in terms of treatment, I think the regular, I mean, if we have non-pharmacologic intervention that we do for our geriatric patients, you know, of any ethnicity, they would be applicable to our seniors in terms of that. And we can address that later in slides. We can probably skip this slide as this is also something that we just pointing out here that when you talk about antipsychotics, some Filipino elders might not want to take that because of the stigma of having a psychiatric diagnosis. So we have to be cognizant of that fact that, you know, they may not
Thank
be
you,
compliant
Arnel.
With this medication.
Is basically, I think many of you are familiar with
and I
the
think,
geriatric assessment
will,
team, and this is more or less the core members of that the group. And
to
just
say,
to emphasize
from
that,
here
that
on,
an assessment is teamwork, and it involves multidisciplinary expertise, and then their observations are put together in a comprehensive report so that then a treatment plan can be appropriately designed. And as far as in the community, there are these are some of the resources that you may be familiar with already in your own region. And internet is now a wonderful resource that you can go to. I also have a slide coming that will give you a few detailed names of community organizations. And so now I'll be talking about caregiving, and these are the topics I will touch on. And we had a community interview a few years ago to check with various community leaders in the Filipino community what are the perceptions and attitudes about dementia. And these are some of the very helpful insights that we got that may be helpful to healthcare providers. There's still the feeling that dementia is really part of aging, and therefore it may not be really necessary to do anything about it. Or if it is, they may believe that it's God's will, it's a punishment or evil spirit, and some kind of help that the family might seek would be a spiritual advisor or a healer. There is no real word used to talk about dementia, but be aware that when there are some Filipinos who would say, my family member has Alzheimer's, be aware that it might not be truly Alzheimer's, because this term sometimes is used as a general term to refer to dementia. And there's also certain kinds of symptoms that they consider just something that's going on in the brain. There is stigma and shame when the diagnosis is established, and may then propel a series of social isolation for the elder as well as the family members. And symptoms may be first observed or shared to a trusted family member or a friend, and psychiatric care is really limited to or are for crazy people, and that healthcare is still a very expensive service. There's also, I think, important to see what the traditional definition of a Filipino family, which is has a very well extended family member. I mean, family. It is an open system. It absorbs new members beyond bloodlines. through compassionate friendship or feelings of indebtedness. And there are shared responsibilities as an element of this extended family. The Philippine family is described as the most able social service system that teaches children to love and respect parents and elders. It is both patriarchal and matriarchal, following male and female roles. In traditional Filipino homes, several generations may live together, and these values are passed on to the young and are deeply integrated into the family system. Family first, before the self, loyalty and interdependence are traits embedded in the Filipino culture, and the family is a source of emotional, moral, and economic support, and that it is best to keep the problems within the family. Superior studied filial responsibility and asked family members whether children should be taught to care for their elders, and there was a resounding yes from all age groups, the young, middle-aged, and the older group. However, the middle-aged group emphasized that they did not expect to live with their children, but expect them to look after their needs. It is possible their preference reflects a degree of acculturation, having lived and raised native-born children in the American culture. Some of the study participants may be in their 60s now, and part of the baby boom generation. The oldest family member is in a traditional Filipino home are the most respected. The highly individualistic social norms in American society tend to lessen the impact of this value on younger Filipino Americans, which may create tensions. A common indication of respect is to greet the older person when the younger family member arrives home from school, from work, or wherever. Titles of respect are practiced widely, such as calling Lolo or Lola, the grandfather or grandmother, respectively, using the word po to emphasize respect, such as saying to a Filipino elder or a stranger, thank you po, and po is spelled P-O, or you could say, how are you po? And according to Filipino social psychologists, filial piety remains strong in Filipino families, and caring for the elder is still rooted in the cultural mores of Philippine society. Alrighty. Next slide. This is the slides in the caregiving pattern that I mentioned earlier. And I had observed this in the Filipino community during my, starting from the 1990s, when I was on my fellowship, and also as I continued my work in ethnic geriatrics and to the present day. The left-hand column has the Tagalog version and the English version on the right hand. The first pattern, relying on ourselves, may work fine in the early stages of an illness such as dementia or Alzheimer's. However, the elder and the family will need help when health needs become more complicated and resources get depleted. The second pattern, search for a strategy, can be problematic since the family and the elder are at risk of missing appropriate professional help. Seeing how it goes may delay early intervention and could bring about a crisis during the early phase of the illness. Visiting family is often an attempt to seek respite by the primary caregiver while sharing elder care responsibility and resources within the family. Getting a trusted companion can be beneficial, especially to the elder who may have limited English proficiency. Most of the time, the companion is brought to the United States, and this person may need to be educated about dementia care. Returning home can be a difficult family option. Family members in the United States become long-distance caregivers, even when the best arrangement is made to the elders for the elders' care and safety in the homeland. One or more of these patterns may be adapted by the family as the elder moves from the various phases of dementia, or family resources change over time. From the clinician's point of view, keeping track of the patient's progress, their medical records, their medications can be a challenge as the family chooses to move from one pattern to another. And therefore, it's so important that an open communication is established within the provider, the patient, and the family, so that then whenever the elder changes addresses, that the care can continue to be seamless. In many traditional families, protecting the elder from external element is often an expression of filial responsibility. Which may be interpreted by those who are unfamiliar with this value as a possible elder abuse situation. Healthcare providers can engage the family in making decisions by establishing who the primary decision maker is, how accessible this person would be, and how the family reaches a decision. This slide offers some insight in the decision-making process, such as understanding the high regard of the elder and the family holds for health professionals, especially the physician. Having this knowledge need to be handled by the clinician with respect and use the privilege to engage the elder and the family in reaching a culturally acceptable choice. Avoiding confrontational discussions, giving clear and non-technical information, including pastoral care, in the treatment plan may help speed up the desired result. In a study of Filipino women in the West Coast, a large number of them indicated that their caregiving experience meant an opportunity to give back to their parents. Sacrifice is an acceptable aspect of caregiving, and suffering along with sacrifice are challenging but important ingredients of the giving back function of the feelings of indebtedness. And now, looking to the future and the long term, there are trends evolving in the Filipino community. There are older Filipinos whose acculturation experience motivate them to choose a lifestyle of living apart from their family and make a success of it, as Arnel had mentioned earlier. There are those who decide to return to the Philippines, despite the family's objection or expression of concern. Some retirees return to the homeland and create resources that they can use when the need arises. I am reminded of a friend's parent who developed a small residential facility in their hometown. Another recently retired couple re-established residence in the Philippines and formed a nonprofit organization focusing on nutrition. They periodically return to the United States to visit their adult children who are native born. They receive their health care in the United States through their Medicare benefits. The bimodal living arrangement seems to benefit the older person and their families. Typically, the older Filipino builds a family home in the Philippines, stays for 3 to 4 months to be with extended family, and returns to the United States to be with nuclear family. And just this back and forth across the Pacific has a lot of implications when they come to the clinic and assess them for if they're presenting with some fever or a little confusion, to see whether there's any kind of infection that was going on picked up during their travels. With the continued improvement of technology and internet services, we can anticipate that the next generation of older Filipino Americans have these resources on their hands and would be looking for ways to apply them in their situation as they age. And these were the list of community resources that I mentioned earlier. The Alzheimer's Association has finally created a group in the Philippines, and I remember about 10 years ago, I was approached by the Secretariat of the International Alzheimer's Society based in London, asking about forming an Alzheimer's Association in the Philippines. And we went through several groups, and at that time the response was that the Philippines wasn't quite ready to start the Alzheimer's Association because typically the association has to be started at the grassroots level, and there aren't groups, visible groups of Filipinos in the community that is yet interested in pushing the fact that Alzheimer's and dementia is a problem that needs to be addressed in the Philippine society. And fortunately, now this is good news because the Alzheimer's Association has started a chapter in the Philippines. The Family Caregiver Alliance specializes on families who are caring for patients who have brain injury or a brain impairment, and so they're very active also in dementia care. The Filipino American Service Group is based in Los Angeles, and they have just started a geriatric clinic, and it's early beginnings, and hopefully that as the years continue and the months and years continue, that there will be a strong geriatric service, and which can be utilized by the community. The Kalusugan Wellness Center is based in San Diego, and they have multi programs, most of it focusing on nutrition and substance use. And the National Alliance that's found based in Florida are more or less a civic and social organization. And the tips for the healthcare providers, I think this may be slightly a repeat of the things that we have said across the different slides. A very important thing is, I think, to look at the level of health literacy for all the people involved in caregiving and healthcare, and that is the elder themselves, their health literacy level, the family members, the caregivers who may be brought in from the Philippines, and some of them may have limited education as well, as and also limited English proficiency. Prayer is a major source of comfort from many of the families as well as the elders, and that having some healer ceremonies or religious rituals are comforting to those who feel that these are helpful to them. Communicating words of concern and respect are very much appreciated in the community. And when the time comes that advanced directives are being to be discussed and no codes are to be decided, try to anticipate and give enough time for the family to deal with this. And when providing information, I kind of call it as giving information in small doses so that then they can wrap their minds around the information and be able to come to an acceptable decision. For those who are very religious and feel spiritual, priests and ministers or a nun are very helpful in helping with any kinds of issues that the family or the elder might be dealing with. I have in the slide here a tool that you could consider using for yourself, and if you're teaching, for your students or for other co-professionals, where it may be a way to find out how much more work you may need to do in terms of shedding some of our stereotypes. We all have stereotypes about different groups and about people. And in Minnesota, they had used this writing exercise for their providers. So feel free to use it for yourself or for your class or for other groups. And in conclusion, we have this community outreach and education can be effective and successful by tapping into the resources in the community, like nonprofit service organizations. At FASHG, for example, and the group in San Diego, I had been invited to give talks about healthcare. Civic and social church groups, professional groups, are another network to tap. Think about the Filipino media, the radio and TV. They have public service announcements, and they may be looking for different topics to air or to show to their audience. Artists and performers may want to write some indigenous types of plays, and I remember going to a performance of an all-Filipino cast of students at the University of California in Davis, and they performed a vignette about the travails of the Filipino veterans and retrace the history of the stories of the Filipino veterans. In a school-based program, I just want to emphasize that similar to what's happening with other communities, some Filipino grandparents are providing parenting to grandchildren or becoming surrogate parents when the adult children are involved with other responsibilities, such as parents who are in the military. So this is a welcome role by Filipino grandparents, and the school system may also be an opportunity or a place to reach out to the grandparents to help them increase their health literacy through intergenerational programs. And these gaps in research on dementia and caregiving in Filipino elders is really enormous. The list here is part of a much longer list. Our hope is some of you and others would in the near future include a Filipino elder in your research activities. We leave you with this information that the prevalence of dementia or Alzheimer's is poorly understood among older Filipinos and including the caregiving process. During the first years of the 9 Alzheimer's disease and diagnostic centers in California, Filipinos comprised 0.7% of the total numbers of individuals who came for evaluation, compared to about 2% of the population of older Californians who also sought evaluation at the center. According to the executive director of the Filipino American Service Group Incorporated, almost all of their low-income older Filipino clients exhibit some form of memory loss. And so herein is a beginning list, and should any of you be interested in pursuing this list in some form, please let us know, and you have our emails. Dr. Arnel, Joaquin, and I have emails, and I have this last slide, and the last, I think, 5 slides following this are the list of references, and feel free to use them. So thank you so much for your patience, and I'm not sure of I was looking earlier for questions.